good to be here.
It's good to be back inside, I must admit. It's good for me to be standing up here with you guys. We did 4 weeks of preaching to a completely empty sanctuary, and that was pretty weird. And then 2 weeks of in the parking lot, and that was less weird. This is better, right?
Okay.
But I have to reiterate some things because we must maintain social distancing. Okay? That's why the chairs are set up this way. Now, it doesn't just apply to while you're seated down, where you're sitting down. Okay? So if you want to get up and go talk to somebody, you have to stay 6 feet away. Okay? We can't go to all the trouble of spacing the chairs like this, and then when they're not in their chairs, everybody's this close to each other.
But today's Joyce's birthday, and I had to give her a hug.
Happy birthday, Joyce.
Happy birthday, Joyce.
Okay. So, please, and I have to tell you, we're not doing this because it's mandated by the government. We're doing this because right now this is the smart thing to do. Okay? Because I have to tell you, look around, okay? We're
old.
A little old.
We're chronologically challenged, okay?
I'm the young person here.
Ashley's the young person, yeah. But Ashley's got underlying conditions too. And honestly, if that disease made its way in here, 25 of you would be dead in a month. So that's not going to happen on my watch.
Amen.
Can I tell you that?
Right.
That's not going to happen on my watch. So if it happens, it's going to be because y'all were doing something stupid. It's not going to be because we weren't careful. And there's, you know, we carry a $2 million liability insurance policy, but if we started doing stupid things and one of you got sick and died, your relatives could sue us. And so all of that has to be taken into consideration. For me, the primary concern is your health.
Yep.
Okay? When it's time for you to go home and be with Jesus, go home and be with Jesus. God bless you.
Yeah.
But it's not going to be because we were stupid.
Yeah.
Okay?
Amen.
So yeah. Feel free to talk to people. Just stay spaced out. Okay? You're all mostly spaced out anyway, so. I know most of y'all pretty well. Okay, so, you know, there's stuff in the bulletin that doesn't really apply right now. I didn't bother to change it all or take it out of there. There are no other meetings except this. Right? We're looking at home groups, but home groups cannot meet and maintain social distancing. So we'll kind of have to just play that by ear as we go forward. I was thinking, yeah, let's just go ahead and do home groups, but second thoughts are sometimes the better thoughts. But this is it for now, probably for 8 Sundays. Okay? Hopefully by the end of June, things will be back to normal. But I gotta tell you, if you watch the news, Russia this morning had their highest day of new cases. Yesterday, India had their highest day of new cases yesterday, and in the United States, 2 out of the last 4 days have been record highs in new cases. So if you think we're done with this, you're kidding yourselves. So when they open everything up and you go back out in public, be careful, because this thing is not over. I don't care what they tell you, it's not over. And our resident nurse, I think, will back me on that.
I back you.
Okay, so be careful out there, because it doesn't do much good to be smart in here and then stupid out there. So don't be stupid anywhere. Amen?
Amen.
Amen to no stupidity. All right, does anybody have anything they want to share with the group this morning? No? Come on, after 6 weeks and not meeting together, you got nothing. All right, well, let's stand up and we will have our time of worship. You guys are very subdued today.
They are.
Sorry, I got a red light. Red is bad. Green is good. Red is bad.
If anyone else comes here, there's a couple of seats up front here on the right. Maybe some others up front.
They're back here.
You know, I have to tell you, when we built this building, it's been finished for 11 years now. When we did this, it's almost like God knew in advance that this was going to happen. Because when we started to have church in the parking lot, was that like not the most ideal setting in the world out there?
Yeah.
With the raised platform for the stage. And then we come in here, and we have a sanctuary that seats 300 people. And now it seats 90, and it's just the right size. God knew everything before.
There's seats down front, folks, that are just coming in.
She heard Jeff.
All right. We're ready to praise the Lord all in one place, right?
You are good.
the cross. And that you, Lord Jesus, the Bible says you would do it for the joy that was set before you. All of that, Lord, just overwhelms us. Your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your love. And Lord, we just want to sit here today and we just want to soak that in. We just want to bask in who you are. Because if we get that, Lord, everything else just kind of seems insignificant. When we know who you are and what you are in our lives, Lord, what problems could we have? Thank you for that reassurance, Lord. Thank you for the promise that you know the end from the beginning. You know where all this is going to end before it ever started, Lord. And you promise us that you are able to bring good out of anything. That's what we look for, Lord. We look for the good because of our faith and trust in you. Bless our time together in the Word this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's open our Bibles to Philippians chapter 3. Important message, Because when we run into situations where we lose things that are important to us, a number of different things happen, right? The first thing that happens to us is we get angry, right? Because it's not fair, right? The second thing that happens to us is we assign blame. Because, hey, it's got to be somebody's fault, right? And the third thing that we do is we kill ourselves. We knock ourselves out trying to get back whatever it is that we lost. Because, hey, it's not fair, and it's got to be somebody else's fault. And the reality is none of those things are helpful. None of them are profitable in any way. And all those three things are a giant waste of time, because what do they involve? They involve looking back. They involve trying to recapture the past. And we will never, ever, folks, find any glory in trying to recapture the past. God is a forward-looking God. Right? And when we try to recapture the past, what are we doing? We're locking ourselves in to less than what God has for us looking forward. You know, the anger, the blame pointing, the trying to recover what we've lost, those things are common, but they do nothing but create stress, and they ignore one fundamental principle that is really easy to ignore in those times when we lose something that's important to us. And that one fundamental principle is that God is in control. And that's hard to remember, especially when you've lost something that you think is important. I was going to say raise your hand if you think God is in control. But let's preface that with something. Let's preface that by saying, if you're going to raise your hand that you think God is in control, I don't want it to be a belief that's just words on a page. Or a belief that represents something that you, it's a catchy line in a sermon that you heard. I want you to raise your hand if you honestly, genuinely believe that God is in control and you're okay with it. Raise your hand.
Yes.
Okay, now keep it up if you think that God is good. Okay, keep it up if you think that God is good all the time. Okay? Even when he does or allows something that you don't like, something that you might think is bad. All right, you can put your hands down. It's not all of you, but it was most of you, which is good. Because if all of that is true, which it is, and you lose something, you have to ask yourself the honest question of who was in control at that. Is God in control all the time, or just when things are going well? At least well in your opinion. I add that last bit because trust me when I say that sometimes when things appear to be going really, really well, that's not good in God's eyes, right? Because you and him have different opinions of what well means, right? You see people who are making tons of money and you think, man, his life is really going well. And God looks in his heart and God sees idolatry. Right? God sees a workaholic. God sees a person who hasn't read his Bible or talked to him in months. So on the outside, you think, man, that guy's life is really going well. God says, that's not well. And sometimes when things appear to not be going well, that's when they're going exactly the way that God wants them to go. Look at the entire history of the nation of Israel, and you see that truth over and over again. And that's going to be an important part of our message for today. When things look bad, God is in control, God is good, and they're going exactly the way that God knew they would go, and he will bring something glorious out of it. That's his promise. And we need to know that because the main character for our study today is you and me. Right? This is about us. It's about you and me and our attitude towards losing. Right? But another main character is the Apostle Paul, who wrote this letter to the church in Philippi. And the Apostle Paul is a guy that used to go by a different name. Right? Remember what the Apostle Paul's name used to be?
Paul.
Saul of Tarsus, right? And Saul of Tarsus, he was a Pharisee. He was a member of the religious ruling council of Israel. And as a Pharisee, Saul was convinced that Christianity was nothing more than an aberrant sect of Judaism, and everything that Christianity stood for was poison to the Jewish faith that Paul knew and loved, or Saul of Tarsus knew and loved so well. And he was convinced that it needed to be wiped off the face of the earth. So that's what he spent his time doing. Saul of Tarsus spent his time traveling around the countryside, persecuting, imprisoning, and even killing Christians. Until the risen Lord Jesus Christ got a hold of him. At that moment, when Saul of Tarsus met the resurrected Christ, he lost everything. He lost everything. Everything that had ever meant anything to him was gone. And today we're going to look at what his attitude was toward that loss. We're going to see that he really, truly thought that loss was glorious. And we're going to see how and when we should have that same attitude. So let's start by reading Philippians chapter 3, verses 4 to 7. And let's take a look at what Saul of Tarsus had to lose. He says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Concerning the law, a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church. Concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss. What an amazing statement. And it's amazing because if you're really open to seeing it, you cannot escape the fact that what Saul of Tarsus lost that day, that was something that was really, really important to a lot of people. Saul of Tarsus lost his sense of self. He lost his concept of who he was, and he lost his sense of what that was worth. He lost his sense of what he was worth. I mean, think about it. Prior to the moment that he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, he had everything and he was everything. He had everything that was important. He had position. He had position in the community and in the synagogue. He had power over people, power to bless them, power to condemn them. He had the admiration of his fellow Pharisees, and to a lesser degree, the admiration of the people. And because of all those things, he also had material wealth and comfort. That's what he had. And on top of that, in addition to all the things that he had, I think that the thing that Saul of Tarsus probably valued most was not what he had, it was what he was. As a descendant of Abraham, as a Jew, as a Pharisee, Saul probably had the idea that God was pretty darn pleased with him. You roll all that into a ball, what you get is a very satisfying sense of self. Some people would call it self-esteem. Saul had what many people today value more than anything else, pride in who he was and pride in what he had accomplished with his life. Now, hopefully you've all lived long enough to know that for most people, that's what really counts. That sense of self and self-identity and self-worth, that self-esteem, that's what really counts. It's not the money. It's not the possessions, the pleasure, the power, the fame. It's not those things. All of those things are only a method of keeping score. Right? Those are just a way of keeping score. I might make $1 million a year in a city where everybody makes $2 million. So am I a success or a failure? Money, power, and possessions are not the goal. They're just a way of keeping score. And what's the prize for a high score in the game of life? Pride and self-esteem. And that's what Saul had. In our world today, that is a valuable commodity. Right? What is it that makes something valuable? Supply and demand. Right? A lot of people want it, and not a lot of people have it. That's the way it is with pride and self-esteem in the world. It's in short supply, and it's in high demand. Everybody wants it. Hardly anybody has it. At least not down inside, where people can't see. People pretend to have it. You might have heard the term that's called a compensatory facade. You know what a facade is, right? It's a false front, like on a building. Compensatory, something that compensates. So people will put up a false front that compensates. Right? When really, you know, people who are really very dissatisfied with themselves and who they are on the inside will pretend to be the most prideful and self-satisfied people that you know, when down inside they're really sad and lonely and scared. And if you go looking for help from professionals about mood disorders and such, what are they going to tell you that you need more than anything else? You need a better self-image. You need more self-esteem. Can I tell you this morning that Saul of Tarsus had that? Right? Saul of Tarsus had that. And that's what he's bragging about here in Philippians 3. And he's bragging tongue-in-cheek, sarcastically, you know, if anybody is going to have confidence in the flesh, they're not going to have it like I had. You know, I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a Pharisee of the Pharisees. Concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. He's telling him about his qualifications. Saul had this great sense of self-worth, and he had lots and lots of positive self-esteem. And he had stuff. He had power, possessions, pleasures. And what happened? The moment he met Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus, all of it evaporated. And it evaporated because God took it away. God took away everything that Saul thought was important. Everything that Saul thought was valuable to him. Everything that gave him a sense of self-worth, a sense of identity. God took away Saul's idea of who he was. Have you been through that yet? Have you been through something? Have you lost something that defined you? And I guess in order to answer that question, you have to think for a minute about what it is that defines you. What it is that makes you who you are. For a lot of men, it's their career. Men are quite often defined by what they do for a living. Well, what do? I build stuff. I'm a carpenter. I'm a builder. I carpent, so I am a carpenter. I don't know if carpent is a verb. And they make the mistake of thinking that what they do is what they are. And then they suffer some kind of injury and they can't build anymore. And they have no idea. Women, on the other hand, are often defined by who they're attached to. A woman gets married, she becomes a wife. She performs all the functions of a wife, she does the things a wife does. So in her mind, she is a wife. And then she has kids, and she becomes a mom. And she does all the things that moms do. So in her mind, she is a mom. And what's really difficult, see, we don't have any problem doing more than one thing at a time, but we have a real problem being more than one thing at a time. So, and a lot of times you'll find in a marriage relationship, women are either a really, really good wife, or they're a really, really good mom. But they struggle with being both. Because while you can do more than one thing at a time, it's really hard to be more than one thing at a time. It's hard to get your sense of identity, who and what you are, from more than one thing. And then her husband goes off the rails and runs off with his secretary. And she's not a wife anymore. And then she turns 40 and the kids are all grown up and moved out of the house. And she's not a mom anymore. And she doesn't know who she is. Where do you get your identity? But I want you to understand something. And if you don't understand anything else today, understand this. Losing the thing that you think defines you, losing your sense of who and what you are, can be glorious losing if you have the right attitude about it. Because it is in those horrifying, agonizing, dreadful moments when God strips away everything that we think defines us, that we learn the truth. We learn the truth that we are not what we were, we are not what we think we are, and it's in that loss that we discover, maybe for the first time, who we really are. That's what happened to Paul, right? And believe me, we need to know who we really are. Because the only time that we will live like who we really are is if we know who we really are. Saul of Tarsus came to that moment when he lost everything, and instead of focusing on what he lost, he focused on what he found. What things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. And he stopped acting like what he used to be, and he started acting like who he had become in Christ. He stopped acting like a destroyer of the kingdom, and he began to act like a builder of the kingdom. See, losing who he thought he was, and losing what he thought he was the best thing that ever happened. And it was the beginning for him of discovering who he really was, and discovering who God thought he was. And isn't that the only thing that really counts? Isn't the only thing that really counts who God thinks you are? I mean, God's the one who said in Jeremiah 1:6, he says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations." God revealed to Jeremiah that he had a glorious plan for him before he was ever born. He was still in his mother's womb, and that's not just true of Jeremiah. That's true of all of you. Before you were ever born, God knew you. God had his plan for your life all laid out. God's the one that said later in Jeremiah, "For I know the thoughts that I think for you, thoughts for good and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." God has thoughts about you. Isn't that amazing? Does that ever blow your mind, that God has thoughts about you? I mean, because it's real easy to think, yes, God interacts with me. When I talk to him, he listens, he answers, but just to think that God's sitting around in heaven just kind of musing about stuff, and he just thinks about you. He just has thoughts about you. Yeah? 7 billion people in the world. God is amazing. God is absolutely amazing. But as every single person who was ever born or will be born, God has thoughts for them, and God has plans for them. And his plans involve good stuff, right? "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which he prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." God doesn't just think about you. God plans stuff for you. He says, "Oh, that Scott Douglas guy who's a debaucherous idiot in Phoenix in his 20s, you know, by the time he gets to be 40, he's going to be pastoring a church in Hartford. And he doesn't even know it yet." And it's going to blow away everybody who knows him. And friends, here's the reality. You will never know the glory of who you are in Christ, who you are in God's eyes, who you are in God's plan, who you are in God's future of good works, until you suffer the glorious loss of everything that you used to be, everything that you thought you were. It is painful, and it feels like a loss, but it is a glorious loss. Please remember, this whole process sounds awful, but it is necessary, because Jesus was the one who said in Luke 9:24, he says, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." Part of following Christ is denying the old you, losing your old life, so that you can go forward into the glorious life that God has for you. Don't try so hard to hang on to your old life. And if you feel like you've lost it, don't try so hard to get it back. I have known many, many believers over the years who put that old life behind them like they were supposed to, and they get 4 or 5 years into their walk with the Lord, and they start going, "Well, some of that was really fun." And they try to recapture. They try to get it back. They try to go back instead of going forward. The only way you can find life, real life, is to lose the life that you have, to put behind you everything that made you who you were, and focus on who Christ remade you to be. And if you're here this morning and you're a believer in Jesus Christ, trust me when I say that you've been remade. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away and all things are made new. That's you. Everything that you were was taken away from you at the moment of your salvation, just like Saul of Tarsus. And rather than feeling sorrow as though it were a loss, we need to see that it was a glorious. Because I'm here to tell you this morning that the new you is way better than the old you. The new you is way more glorious than the old you. And if you haven't discovered that yet, that means you haven't let go of the old you. I mean, think of who was more glorious? Saul the Pharisee or Paul the Apostle? Who was more glorious?
Paul.
And whose life was better? That's a hard question, isn't it? How many of you, don't raise your hands, but how many of you, when I said whose life was better, you went, well, Saul. That's the knee-jerk reaction, right? Well, Paul's life was far more glorious, but it was a hard, hard, hard life. I don't think he saw it that way. I don't think he saw it that way at all. You know, we often labor too long and too hard under the notion that there was something about the old us that was useful. That there was something that was redeemable, something good that we should bring along with us into our new life. There wasn't. And I'll be honest with you, God is merciful. Because sometimes he takes part of your old life, and if you will let it go, he will bring it back in a new form. Right? I've been a musician forever. I could sing since I was about this high. But I used it for the wrong thing. I used it to glorify me. And when I was willing to let that go, God said, okay, you can have it back now if you'll use it for me. So it wasn't like I took what I was and I drug it into the kingdom with me. It was like, I said, okay, it can go. And God said, good, now I'll take it, I'll make that something new, and I'll give it back to you over here. There's nothing about the old us that's glorious in the kingdom of God. As I said, and in a minute we're going to see that Paul the Apostle referred to everything about Saul of Tarsus. He referred to everything about his old life, his old him, as rubbish. And before we do that, before we get into the last bit of this, I have to add one more thing. Sometimes you have to lose more than what you do and what you think you are. Sometimes you have to lose what you have. Because sometimes people are more defined by their possessions than they are by anything else. Don't raise your hand again, but I think you probably all know somebody whose identity is defined by a possession. Right? You might be standing around in a small group of people and they'll be talking and all of a sudden somebody will mention somebody's name and you go, that sounds familiar. Who is that? And they go, oh, you know, he's the guy with the whatever. And you go, oh, yeah. Doesn't matter what it is. All that matters is when they mention that thing, you know who they're talking about. And usually they like it that way, right? What person who spends $80,000 for a new truck doesn't want to be driving down the street thinking people are going, there's the guy with the new truck. They want to be defined by that possession. And when that possession becomes the source of that person's identity, what else does it become? It becomes an idol. Our former pastor in Phoenix, Bob Playcamp, amazing, amazing man of God, servant of Jesus Christ for decades. He was part of the Calvary Chapel movement when it started in the early 70s. Just has served the Lord with everything that's in him, even moving to England to pastor a Calvary Chapel in England. And he's also a pretty big guy. If you were here for the sanctuary dedication, you saw him. He's 6'2"-ish, 220. But there was this one car that he always wanted, and he finally got it. It was a Mini Cooper. And he loved that car, and he drove it everywhere, and it was really funny watching him get out of it in the church parking lot. This great big guy getting out of that little car. And then one day he drove like a Volkswagen Jetta to the church or something, and I asked him, I said, what happened to your Mini Cooper? And he said, I had to get rid of it. He said it was becoming an idol. He just loved it so much. See, he was becoming known as the guy with the Mini Cooper. And instead of being known for who he was in Christ, who he was in the eyes and heart of God, he was the guy with the car. This is 20-some years ago when they were really rare and you didn't see them anywhere. This next part is only speculation, but I'll tell you what I think. I think that if he had not been sensitive and responded to the conviction of the Holy Spirit and gotten rid of that car on his own, I think God would have taken it away from him somehow. Because Pastor Bob had to lose that car in order to be all he could be in Christ. It was a loss, but it was a glorious loss, and he saw it that way, and he gave it up glad. And that was Paul's attitude about the whole thing. Let's read the last portion of this passage and we'll close for this morning. Verse 8 to 10. He says, yet indeed I also count all things loss. All things. I count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. He says that he lost all things. And when you look at his old life versus his new life, it's one of the cleanest breaks you will ever see. He literally lost everything. But in his mind and in his heart, it was all rubbish. It was all garbage. See, Paul knew that he couldn't be everything he was supposed to be in Christ if he still saw himself as a Pharisee, if he still saw himself as a Jew, if he still saw himself as a righteous man, if he still saw himself as a servant of the law of Moses. So even though each one of those things was of immense value to him in the world that he came from, he counted them all a glorious loss so that he could know who he was in Christ. He now knew who he was in the righteousness of Christ, who he was in the resurrection of Christ, who he was as an apostle of Christ, and even who he was in the fellowship of the sufferings of Christ, even in his death. That's who Paul had become. But there was no room for it with all that other stuff in there. If he had tried to hang on to any of his old life, it would have been in the way of him being what he had been recreated in Christ to be. And in just two verses from here, Philippians 3:13, Paul writes, look, one thing I do, forgetting the former things which are behind, and reaching forward to those which are ahead, I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. That was his mindset. One thing I did. Just one. Everything else that Paul did with his life was defined by that. Pressing toward the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. The question for each of us this morning is as profound as it is simple. Have you left behind what you used to be and become who God has recreated you? Have you looked at everything that you did, everything that you had, everything that you were, and decided that it was all garbage. And if you have, did you see that as a glorious loss? Or do you spend all of your time grumbling about it and trying to get it back? Each of us has to decide the answer to some fundamental questions. Who are you? What defines you? You need to know the answer to that question because you need to know the answer to it, and you need to know where to find the answer to it. Because if you don't know who you are, if you don't know what you are, there are plenty of people in this world that will tell you. And they may not be speaking for God. I want to close our time this morning with a short clip from a recent movie. It's called Overcomer. And a big part of the plot of this movie is about this young lady learning the answer to the very question that we're talking about this morning. So if you'll kill the lights and start the video, this is about 3 minutes. Just heard was the result. Now she knows who she is. Don't let what you do, or what you have done, or what you have, or what you think you are, don't let it define you. Because if it's part of your old life, if it's part of your old identity, it's rubbish compared to who you are in Christ. Too many people wander through life never really knowing who they are, never discovering their identity. Don't let that happen to you. Let's pray. Father God, we are, Lord, we're just blown away that you have that intimate personal plan for each one of us, Lord, that we can know who we are in your heart and in your mind and in your plan for your body and for this world. And I pray, Lord, for each one of us that we would spend more time seeking who you desire for us to be going forward and less time trying to recapture who we were in the past. Lord, we know that your plan's better than ours. We know that your future's better than our past. I just pray that you would help us to really, really believe that, so that like Paul, Lord, we would press forward for the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand. So that you can become the new you. God bless you all. Think about it.